I'm very pleased to see you today for this series of our gender equality webinar on the topics of culture and constitution, which has been put in place by Nashan Randjak, Valeria Arena, and Marijke Fleuren. So a huge thank you to them. So just to facilitate the interaction during the meeting, and this is very important, I kindly ask you to mute your devices. So please turn off your microphone and also switch off your webcam, please. Everyone apart of our panelist and Sarah Jeggins, which is our mentor. This might also help to have a good connection, so thank you very much. Should you have any question during the discussion, do not hesitate to ask them via the meeting chats, and we'll do our best to interact in live with you. I will also give you on this chat the email address of my colleague Valerie, so if you have any question after the webinar, do not hesitate to contact her. She will be happy to get back to you. As you know, the gender equality program is hugely important for our federation, and it is absolutely great to see you all today. I think that we are a bit more than 30 people from all around the world for this meeting, so thank you very much to you all. I think that I've already spoke too much, so please let me now give the floor. I don't know if Nashan is already in or not. If he's in, Nashan, you can take the lead, otherwise I will give it to Marijke. I don't know.
We don't see him coming in, do you?
No.
Okay. No, he's not in.
Okay. Now, then I will talk for Nashan this time. Fortunately, he's always very good to speak on behalf of himself, but now there seems to be some difficulty. A very warm welcome to all of you from all over the world. I've seen indeed all continents represented, so we are very proud of that. This time we are together for the webinar coming from Africa. As you know, maybe we from the WISC committee within FIH, we are having webinars from all over the world. And all these webinars are different because the continent itself decides what is the subject for the webinar, and also who are the panelists. And the reason we do that this way is because we know that all the continents have different backgrounds and different items to discuss. Today, the subject is culture and constitution. And you can imagine that's quite a serious subject. But for Africa, it seems to be very important that we start with the basis, that indeed in the constitution is reflected that men and women are equal, that they must have equal opportunities, and also that everybody understands that by doing things together, it will be better. It's not men against women, it's men together with women. And we within FIH really believe that we are a kind of a role model for other federations, sport federations in the world, to show that we make it happen. We have a huge number of panelists today, and I'm sure that Sarah will introduce them all. You can see Sarah Jukens, she's our moderator today. She will introduce all her panelists and their background. And the special thing of today is that it not only are people from hockey, we have also other sports involved, like rugby, like shooting, and we have also people from NOCs involved. So maybe people coming from other continents can do their profit with it, that if we come to your continent and we have to go still to Asia, to Europe and to Oceania, that you know it doesn't need to be always people from hockey. We want to learn from each other, and together we want to be better. I hope you will join, or you will enjoy enormously this webinar. I give the word to Sarah, and please, if you have a question, ask it, and then we make the dialogue more fresh. Thank you so much, Sarah. Good luck.
Thank you. Thank you, Marijke. And welcome everyone to this gender webinar focusing on the Africa Hockey Federation. The theme, culture and constitution, is huge. But what I'm really hoping today, through the words of wisdom from the panelists, that we're going to come up with some certainly some challenges. We're going to identify some barriers, but most importantly of all, at the end of this session, we will have something that we can tangibly take away that every single national association can use in some way, shape or form to improve the situation within their country. We are joined by guests from as far afield as Germany, Austria, Malta, the Czech Republic, Canada, Indonesia, Vietnam, Cameroon, South Africa, Guyana. There's a wealth of experience within this entire webinar. So as Marijke said, if you've got questions or comments, please do type them down in the chat box or contact Valerie at the end of the session to put your points of view across. It's just such a pleasure to be hosting this, so I'll just say that now as well. I'll now introduce you to the panelists. As Marijke said, I think it's really interesting today. We haven't just got hockey players on board. We're talking to people from other sports and from a range of nations. And I think this collaborative and sharing approach is so important because there will be best practice and ideas from every single sport that hockey can take on board, and equally other sports can take on board too. So, without any further ado, our guests, we have Caroline McGardy, who is a financial market consultant, a former Kenyan international hockey player, and she was also the first female board member at the Kenyan Rugby Union from 2007 to 2010. And just before we came on air in front of you all, she also said that she's now throwing her considerable talents into golf. So welcome to you, Caroline. How are you today? Okay, that was Caroline. We've also got Doreen Okiri. She works in the technology investment sector. Doreen is an air pistol shooter, a Kenyan Women's Sports Shooting Club founding committee member, and the Kenyan National Olympic Committee Women in Sports Commission member. So welcome to you, Doreen, as well. Hi. That's Doreen there.
Give us a mic. Hi, everyone. Thank you.
Then we have Gurupreet Danjal, the managing director of Colour Tunes Kenya. He's a sports rifle shooter and the Secretary General of the Kenyan Sports Shooting Federation. Hi, Gurupreet. How are you today?
Hi. I'm well.
Perfect. Elizabeth King is here. She's the former director of prisons in Ghana, the chairperson of the Women's Commission of the Ghana Olympic Committee, the vice president of the Ghana Hockey Association, the African Hockey Federation treasurer, and an FIH executive board member. Certainly a lot of roles there to keep you busy. Hi, Elizabeth. There she is, waving to, sorry, in the corner there. And then we have Jacqueline Mwangi, sports and ICT school teacher, a former Kenyan international hockey player, now coach to the Kenyan women's national team. She's chair of the African Hockey Federation Athletes Committee, and she's a member of the FIH Athletes Committee, as well as being the FIH Development and Education Committee member. Hi, Jackie.
Hi, everyone.
There she is. Brilliant. The first thing I'd like to do, really, is just to come to each of you briefly. And just what I'd like you to do is outline the experiences of women in your own sport and your own country, focusing on just three areas, because I'm very aware this could be a huge discussion for each of you from every single sector. So if we can focus in on three areas, and if you could give me a very brief overview of what grassroots participation in your sport looks like in terms of gender, the opportunities to take on leadership roles within your sport, and the presence of females within the organisations that run the sport. So three areas, three brief answers on that. And if we go to Caroline first. Okay, Caroline.
Well, for this opportunity, I believe you'd like me to outline the experiences of women in my sector, and I think you are leaning into rugby. Maybe I should say that I have played both hockey and rugby at the national level for my country, and I was also an athlete. I used to sprint. I moved to rugby after hockey, and in rugby I played, and I was also I was actually co-opted into the Kenya Rugby Union. The experience I have seen is that there was a deliberate, intentional approach towards including women in the game. My role as a director on Kenya Rugby Union and also the chair of the Women's Committee was to grow the numbers. We had a number that we wanted to achieve. So we went to the grassroots and created development programs for the women. So initially there was, it was clearly discriminative because there were certain things that the men got and there were things that the women were not getting. It was a challenge for women, and it is still today, to get to the pitch, you know, to pay small things like bus fare, to get to the pitch, to pay for their kit, to pay for medical and so forth. At the moment, there's been a deliberate effort at the union level to have a budget that supports women activities. And so it is possible to see a lot of girls playing. The numbers have grown almost tenfold from over the past 10 years. We targeted 10,000, we went over 10,000. Rugby is being played across the country. Rugby is being played by girls at the primary school level. Rugby is being played by Kenya at the Olympics. What has the experience been with regards to opportunities to take leadership? There are very deliberate efforts to ensure that women are taking leadership roles. There's training, both by IRB and the Kenya Rugby Union. And when I sat on the board, I was the first woman. I was co-opted. We have since seen women competing in elective positions and being elected into the Kenya Rugby Union. So I want to say that there's hope and there's opportunity for more to be done. I have chosen to speak about rugby, but I've also been in hockey. But since we are many of us here representing hockey, I'll allow others to speak about hockey. But I will chip in also on hockey. So I don't know, Sarah, if I've answered your question.
Yeah, that's perfect. Thank you. And I think one of the things that we can all take from that is the fact that you said in the first instance you were co-opted, but since then females have been elected onto the board, which means that it's almost the start of a rollout procedure, which I think is really important. You know, sort of put someone in position, see that they do a good job, and then you see the rollout continue after that, which is great. But thank you very, very much for that insight.
And maybe I should add that at the Rugby Union, there is actually a women's committee. So there's a deliberate effort to have a system that actually just looks at the women's game and develops that game. So the voice is then heard at the table specifically for women. And that does not mean that men are left out. It just means that there's the realization that the men's game had gone far ahead of the women's game, and that there could be certain things that the women might be facing that the men are not. And so there's a deliberate voice. There's a deliberate voice that speaks for the women's game, that gives updates on the development programs that are taking place, that actually asks for budget for developing that game. Thank you.
That's brilliant, thank you. I see Nashon has just joined us. So hi Nashon, how are you? He's there. Well, we'll come back to you.
I'm fine, thank you. My apologies for coming in late. You know, I'm in my rural home attending a burial ceremony, and I had to request for leave so that I can join in and finding where there is a stable internet was a problem to begin with, but I think I'm okay now. Okay. And I'm happy to see all the faces. Can I be heard clearly? Are you hearing me? Okay, so I'm happy to see everybody and happy to see the event rolling off, and I hope that it will have a happy ending.
I echo that. Okay, Doreen.
Supposed introductory opening speech, but because I'm late, I think I will not rewind the process. I think we just carry on. It's okay.
Okay, Nashon, what we'll ask you to do, Nashon, is perhaps wind up at the end with your thoughts, because Marijke very kindly stepped in and gave an introduction. So we'll come to you at the end for your summing up comments.
Thank you. That will be perfect.
Okay, brilliant. Right, and Doreen, can we come to you now for the same question that I put to Caroline, sort of a brief overview of your situation?
Yes, thank you. Thank you for that question, Sarah. So in sports shooting, we do have the unique ness of our sport in terms of that we do use weapons, and you know, the GANs that we use have to be approved by the national security arms of government, and even how they're utilized and how we train is restricted by that. And so this does have an impact to all participants, to all athletes, and particularly the women. And why I say is that firstly, the cost of the sport is fairly high. So there has to be quite a bit of, sorry, there's a bit of background noise. I think there's someone who needs to mute.
Brian, can we just emphasise that everybody needs to mute their buttons?
Thank you for that. Okay. So firstly is the cost of the sport. And this is restrictive, not only for men, but also for women. And, you know, when you're prioritising your household budget or your budget in general, you and trying to figure out, okay, so how much will I put into ammo, which is required during training and also during competition? There has to be that balance. And then where we train. So training has to be done at an approved range, so access to the range. If anyone is familiar with Nairobi traffic, especially lately, it is an effort to get there, in addition to the constraints we have with the curfews. So when you're juggling, you know, your children coming home from school at a particular time, or taking care of the household in addition to your regular work, in addition to finding time for training, that becomes restrictive because we only have a number of training areas within Nairobi or even within the country in general that our athletes can access. But despite that, we have been having a number of drives to ensure that we have more ladies participating. And as part of the Kenya Women Shooting Committee, we have been actively driving that by having women-only shoots to encourage more women to participate in a what I'd call a safe environment. Relatively safe environment. Reason being, because that gives us more opportunity to interact with each other, learn from each other, and also have more opportunities to win different prizes. And we've seen an amazing uptick on that. Another major change that we've seen in our sport is that in, especially in the air weapons, a few years ago, our International Committee, International Sports Shooting Federation, allowed for both men and women to have mixed teams, and also for the competition number of shots are similar. So we have 60 shots for the men and also 60 shots for the women. So it has risen the competition not only for among the women in themselves, but the women can also comparatively see where they are with their male counterparts. And it has really brought in a lot of encouragement from our male counterparts who are saying, hey, you know, you're shooting really well and you can do much more. So that is very exciting for us as well. In terms of leadership, we still have quite a bit of work to do there, as we do have a mix of shooters from both the disciplined forces and also civilians. And this is something that our committees are working on actively to address, in addition to bringing in more shooters at athlete level.
Brilliant, thank you. Can I ask you a quick question there, just based on that?
Yes, please.
Have you found that the push for more opportunities and the wider availability of prizes has led to a realisation that there can be actual careers within maybe coaching or within shooting itself? Has there been more, a more professional approach among female shooters?
So one of the constraints that we have is that a lot of the shooters work within the disciplined forces. So we have very limited control as to how they would like to develop their careers in that regards. But there has definitely been interest of more women putting up their hands in various roles, coaching being one of them. We have run as the NOC a number of sessions for women training. And we've seen a lot of participants from the women's side in shooting showing interest in that. And I think there could be that correlation.
Brilliant, thank you. We'll stick on the theme of shooting. Gurupreet, can you tell us your experiences, please?
Yeah, I think Doreen and I are colleagues when it comes to sports shooting. and she summed it up quite well. What I would like to add is that the theme of gender equality is being led from our International Federation. As Doreen has rightly said, in the past few years, the Federation has changed the system to make sure that equality becomes one of their main agendas, just as the IOC has done with the Olympic quest, where the number of athletes should more or less be equal. The ISSF has now made it mandatory that the events that are going to take place at the Olympics are gender equal, and we are one of the few sports that have mixed teams at the Olympics, where a man and woman from the same country represent at this at an event against others, but they are competing together. So it's a really unique type of system that I think is going to be tried out at the at this Olympics for the first time. They've done it at a few World Cups. And it's really interesting because what we have noticed is that once they brought the number of shots, like Doreen said, to 60 instead of 40, which they were shooting earlier, the scores are even higher when it comes to women. Women are shooting better in certain events than men. So in sports shooting, definitely we have seen that gender neutrality is not a problem. We have some sports that have been shooting together, like football shooting, have been combined, men and women, from its outset, ever since we started. In terms of trying to grow the sport at grassroots level, that's where we find our main challenge. As Doreen said, we use firearms. Firearms are highly regulated. They are not something that you can put in the hands of kids to start with. The problem we have is the sensitization. We are working with the ministry, the National Olympic Committee, and our stakeholders to try and tell them that sports shooting is not, you know, when somebody just hears the word shooting, the first thing that comes in your mind is what you see in the movie. They don't realize that it's actually a sport on its own. So again, with the help of the International Sports Shooting Federation, they have come up with an event which is called Target Sprint. It is it's an event akin to biathlon, where you have an athlete running, and then they come and shoot at stationary targets. So we are at an advanced stage to try and get approvals and try and sensitize the government and the licensing bodies that this is something that can be done in a safe environment, and it can be done in school. Because you see, if we are relying on the forces and like the police and the army, the catchment age becomes higher. You're trying to get athletes who are 21 years plus. And as we all know, sport nowadays is becoming younger and younger. If you don't have your athletes starting at the age of 12, by the time they are 18, in some sports, they're already too late. So that's where we have a problem, but we are working on it. And I'm sure hockey has its own challenges, but sports shooting is unique in that respect, because our main tool, which is the firearm, is the one that's restrictive. However, we are working on it. When it comes to leadership, Doreen has mentioned the Kenya Women's Shooting Club. This is an initiative that was started by the Kenya Sports Shooting Federation specifically to promote women shooting. We realized that they need to have their own club where they can interact and not have the influence of, you know, when it comes to the disciplined forces, hierarchy will remain. Whether you are a better shooter than your superior, in terms of hierarchy, due to the way they are trained, will always remain. So they're not that free to speak their mind. When you have an open forum like a club that they can actually talk to their peers, highlight their issues, and then bring it to us as a federation and say that this is what we are facing as challenges, then we can do something about it. But I'll keep it short, and that's just what I wanted to add.
That's fantastic. Thank you. It really sounds in many respects that shooting is really pushing ahead with gender neutral competition, which is great to hear. Let's hear from the two hockey representatives now. Elizabeth, are you with us at the moment? There you are. No, that's Jackie. Is Elizabeth with us? Okay. Well, there she is. Right, okay, Elizabeth. Yeah, if you could just talk about the situation as you see it at the moment.
Yeah.
I've been into hockey for a very long time.
Oh, we've just lost you for a moment there, Elizabeth. Okay. Brian, if you could try and get Elizabeth back, and we'll head over to Jackie first. So, Jacqueline, if you could take up the mantle, just outline the experience. Oh, sorry, she's back, I think. Are you back, Elizabeth? Apologies, everybody. No, Jackie, let's come to you. If you could just talk about your experiences within hockey and within your country, that'd be great. Jacqueline, are you with us?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you repeat the question?
Yes, if you could just outline the experiences within your own setup, starting first of all at grassroots and how the participation levels are balanced between males and females. Elizabeth, we'll come to you in a minute if that's okay.
Hello, Sarah, can I continue?
Elizabeth, we'll come back to you in just a moment.
Right.
Okay.
Yes, we have five actresses here in Ghana, so that is
okay. Elizabeth, if you just wait a moment, I'll just get Jackie to comment, then I'll come back to you. Okay. So Jackie, grassroots level, opportunities to take on leadership roles, and the presence of females within governing organisations. And Brian, can we just sort that sound quality out, please?
Okay, great. That's very grateful to be here this great event, because it's historical that we have webinars like this. For my setup and the grassroots, I think we've seen a lot of growth within our country. For example, in Kenya, there's a lot of growth on the ground. We have several projects, one in Mombasa, one coming up in Nakuru, one in Eldoret, one in Kisumu, at least four cities, which hasn't been there before. These NGOs or organizations that are coming up to try and grow the sport. In as much as that is happening, we had a lot of, in the past, we had a lot of male people in leadership trying to have this sort of grassroots projects running. But of late, it's been a considerable amount of women coming in to assist and even make sure that the projects are running well on the ground. We also have a lot of coaches being educated, which has been one of the things that the union has been intentionally trying to do. Just to get more women educated, that way they can step into leadership positions. So we hope that as much as we have hockey in the secondary schools, we can grow it to the primary schools and continue growing it within the university sector, and hopefully have more clubs and better teams in the national team. So in that regard, we can say that there is considerable growth in the grassroots, not only in Kenya. I think we have several projects, I think in Ghana, in Nigeria, I think there's one starting up, Zambia, Botswana, there are a lot of, and Tanzania, and not forgetting Uganda. I think you noticed that there was a lot of improvement with their play of late. So that's why we're having these grassroots projects happening. In terms of leadership, like I said, education is important for Kenya, just that growth in having women be more educated on the sport so that they can take leadership opportunities. So that has been good. Yeah, and also Africa Hockey has also been in the forefront, just from IFH, and Asia Hockey is also happening. So I can see a lot going forward, and I think the future is bright.
Brilliant. We'll come to Elizabeth in a minute on that as well. Jackie, just one question. Is this happening in pockets, or are you seeing a wide dispersal across the continent in terms of hockey development activities?
Okay, I think it's in a few countries. I think our plan is to get it to as many countries as possible. I think we've normally had maybe, say, about 6 to 8 countries going for the main tournaments, the Africa Cup. But I think our main goal is to get it bigger, get almost all the countries involved going forward. Yeah. So there's a lot of small projects going around.
Fantastic. So it's a question really of joining some of those projects up and maybe having leagues and competitions out of those. Brilliant. Elizabeth, I apologise. We lost you halfway through your talk there. But can you just give us a little bit of a summing up of the situation in Ghana? And I mean, I know just from looking at Ghana in the last few years, there's been a lot of work going on there, as there has been in Kenya as well.
Yeah, in Ghana, things are not moving on as we expected. In fact, we only have one turf, and it's overused, and therefore we are now laying a new turf, and therefore it makes training and then planning for hockey tournament very, very tough for us. We have regional organizations, regional hockey federations or associations, but then they are not functioning because we are still playing on grass in the various regions. We are now laying the turf there. Fortunately, our boss, president, has been able to secure about 4 turfs, which we're going to use in the various regions, especially in the university levels. But I must say that moving forward with hockey in Ghana, it hasn't been very easy. Hitherto, we have been talking about mates. But in Ghana here, I don't think the mates surrounding female participation is the most important point, because it has been corrected for some time now. But then the problem now is the trying to break the myth of the men dominance in hockey, especially in Ghana. When you come to sports administration, you come to sports coaching, you come to sports management, women are really underserved. We are not many there. If you take the National Hockey Association, for example, we have only 2 ladies on the association, as against 13 men. And where you have men dominance in any federation, you see, and then we have a few ladies, sometimes it's very difficult to get your voice heard. And therefore, it makes gender parity difficult, especially where women sports is concerned. Even if you look at even our Ghana Olympic Committee, which is supposed to oversee the national associations, you have only one woman in the executive board. And therefore, that creates a problem for decision-making for women, where the coaching and other things are concerned. And in Ghana here, we take football as a major sport. And that is also male-dominated. You know, when you go for women's football, you have few spectators. If you come to hockey, women's participation in hockey, you have few spectators. But then if you have men playing, you have a lot of spectators there. And therefore, we don't even have gate proceeds as compared to men events. And therefore, financing and sponsorship for especially women events, at this time, not even only hockey, but all women events, becomes really, really difficult. And then if you also look at the media exposure, you realize that it is not as the men we have in the men's event. You have, it comes just a flash, maybe 5 minutes, whereas the men, it takes about the whole 90 minutes. You have the women's one coming in about 15 or 20 minutes, and then it goes off. So the interest is not much there. We are trying to get into the grassroots. We realize that the ladies themselves, we ourselves, are not even interested because of the because we are grown and then the myth had been with us. So we're trying to go to the grassroots to be able to catch them young, where those myths and other things, they are not privy or they are not prone to those ones. So be able to groom them to be able to get rid of those myths and other things. And then you realize also that childbirth, most of the ladies, you know, with African countries, you realize that childbirth, marriage and childbirth is a priority. And therefore they go and deliver and then come back. But then when they come back with their children. And then there's no facility unless somebody holds the child, you know, the person cannot play. And therefore, if we are able to get something, not only in Ghana, but probably most African countries, I guess, you have something like a crash in the stadia where maybe if you have a child and then you can leave the child and then go and play, we'll have a lot of them coming in. But where you are torn between your child and then the playing of hockey and then your husband, as the culture of Africa is, then it becomes really difficult to be able to sustain the interest and passion of women. And therefore, it was only last year that the Women's Commission was inaugurated. And we're trying to see how best we can go to the grassroots and also to empower women to take up into coaching, sports administration, etc., so that we'll be able to let our voice be heard as a men. Without this, it will be very difficult to be able to get hockey or what it's termed here in Ghana as a lesser known sport to be able to progress as the other sports like football. And therefore, I might say that we have our strength. The strength is that we are more than the men. And therefore, we can get a lot of women playing. But these are some of the problems that I have already enumerated. We have our weaknesses. Our weaknesses, you know, sometimes we don't even that is a male dominance in the sports there. Even if we take even our sports ministry, we haven't had even one woman being a sports minister for a very long time. And therefore, we have a very serious challenges here in Ghana. But we're trying. We have other women organizations, sports organizations, trying also to help. We have women sports, women in sports, WASPA, and we have Sportsnet Ghana, and then we have AWISA, which we are, we've all come together to see how best we can grow up this women's sports in Ghana. I think this is what I have to say for now. If there are questions, maybe later we'll take it up. But I must say that I have been a sports player, a coach, a team manager, and now an administrator with the various boards. But then nothing much, except that the passion, because of the security services, you know, they take the young ones into the security services. And that is where we have bulk of our national teams. Other than that, we will not be able to have them. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks, Elizabeth. You've highlighted a whole heap of different issues there that we will now thrash out a little bit and explore. And what I'd like to do now is open it up to sort of a discussion. So there are five of you there. You'll all have things to say, I guess, about most of these issues. So if we can keep it fairly fast flowing. So if you've got a point to make, I'll come to each of you so that you can make a point as you wish. But we'll try and just get a lot of ideas now from the people on the panel. So something that Elizabeth spoke about was the home life, the fact that you know, family takes precedence over sports for females. Family takes precedence over sport. It takes precedence over careers. That instantly makes it difficult for a talented youngster, if we're talking about young players, to take their sport as seriously as they might like. So I just wondered if I could come to Caroline first, really, from your experiences both in hockey and in rugby. How can we start to challenge the culture, if you like, or society, to say, look, you know, a young female actually could make herself a good career. It might not be within the sport, but by participating in sport, she can get a better education, she can get a better career, she can have a wider outlook on life through more participation in sport from an early age. How can we change the sort of the thinking around that?
All right. If I speak from my personal experience, as a young child growing up, I was very active, and I was gifted academically, and so it was expected that I would proceed and go to the university and get a career like maybe a doctor, an engineer, and so forth. And throughout my life, I had an opportunity to play and still do well in my academics. It's only when I joined high school that I found myself in proper competitive sport. It was like, wow, you know, I had access. I was in every school team. I was in the athletics, the track team. I was in the hockey team, volleyball. I was in the music club and excelled in the same and represented my province and got even shortlisted for national assignments. And the thing that kept on coming across is that my parents were always concerned that how will this sport interfere with this, you know, bright career and future they had for their daughter. And the more I continued to qualify, to represent my country, I mean, at the university, I was selected to the national team for the very first time. And that is where the clash came. I had exams, and then the national team had to travel to Zimbabwe for the Africa Championship. And the school said that if I went to represent my country, I would have to come back and repeat. And my parents stepped in and they said, no, you can't do that. You have to prioritize your education. And this is a challenge I have seen that befalls many girls and many families, that how do you choose? You know, a day only has 24 hours. And when education is one of the biggest things in a family budget, the family will sell their house, it will sell their cow, it will... The biggest part of the family budget is trying to get a good education for their children. And in Kenya and in Africa, everybody has always traditionally believed that education is the key to the future. Now, here is a student who is spending a lot of time, quality time in the sport, and getting injuries that stop you from playing your normal course at home. You know, with the injuries in the hands, before the turf came, we played on Maram and we bruised our hands and we had injuries. And so my parents were not keen to see me play. But as I started to score and to get awards and to get certificates, my father was as an administrator in sport. He was the secretary general of one of the football clubs in the Premier League. And he was proud that I was getting, you know, accolades. And these accolades helped me to get into my career. I didn't realize then, but through mentorship and coaching, I realized that sport helped me to embody the same skills that get you into a career: teamwork, discipline, results orientation, you know, the ability to fail and still come back and face tomorrow, and so many other things, diligence, you know, the ability to push yourself, the ability to play with people that, you know, the ability for conflict resolution and so forth and so forth. And I found myself squarely landing into a career in banking. My undergrad is BSc Chemistry and Math. It has nothing to do with banking, but I was adaptable and able to learn and grow to the C-suite in banking. I've been treasurer of two banks in Kenya. I've held senior management roles. And it becomes evident that sports polishes you for career. And human resource directors and everybody wants to look at that. So I think it's important that we have to throw out this in the marketplace. We have to speak to families. We have to speak to the heart of the community to say that when your daughters or your sons play sport, it is also a pathway to career. It is also as a pathway to money. The challenge which comes is that when this sport does not bring money home and an investment has been made, then families struggle. The young girls that Elizabeth is talking about, I had my son when I was playing for the national team in Kenya. And you take the child to the sports field because the sports community helps you to babysit. Because as you're playing, somebody else is taking care of them and everybody else has brought their child. But again, you find that our hockey coach then used to take us home and involve our parents in the sport. I remember one player, her father was a senior manager in some organization. He was made, guest of honor in a tournament so that he could appreciate that there is something that the sport, that the daughter is not just getting lost. So yeah. There are a lot of things that one has to look at, because the woman today is the mother. And when relationships break out, you're left with the children. You have to provide food. You have to provide electricity. A lot of us support our parents back at home. So if the time in the sport is not going to be monetized or commercialized, then at that point, you will have a lot of women dropping off, because the love for the sport does not put food on the table. Yeah. It does not pay school fees. And if we find a way to commercialize or to monetize the sport, if hockey can be converted into a business, it can help people to come and be able to provide. I have so many, today the schools are opening tomorrow. I have so many women down at the grassroots asking me for school fees, asking me for that. And the men will sit at home. They might go and have a drink and come back and expect to find a meal on the table. So if we can keep the women and ensure that the woman as a whole, you know, she's a hockey person, but she's also a mother, she's a sister, she's a provider. If that can be addressed, then it can keep the women connected. But going to the current leadership, we have to find out.
Sorry, we've lost you, Caroline. Caroline, we've lost you. Sorry, we've lost Caroline for a minute. Jackie, can I come to you as a teacher? And can I just ask you, is there a growing awareness within education circles? And I'm only saying this now because we've certainly only just found it in... can you hear me okay?
I can hear you.
Great. I'm sorry. I think we're only just realising that wherever you are in the world. But are teachers realising that sport is a really great way of also helping somebody achieve a very great academic career, as Caroline has just outlined?
Oh, yes. It's very important to have sport in education, because it enables somebody to be able to have a place to outlet, deal with stress, a place to, like Caroline Ugadi talked about, learn other life skills, such as teamwork, such as dealing with people that you can't normally cope with in normal life, interacting. You might be an introvert, but when you go into a team setup, you now learn how to interact with others. So it's very important to have education in a child's education or in a child's life education or an adult going forward. I also want to add one point that Carol mentioned about getting coverage. I think one way that we can move forward is getting more coverage for women in sports media. I think in Kenya, we had a time, I think, 2-3 months ago when Kipchoge won the marathon and he broke the record. And I think that's all people talked about. But there was somebody else there, Bridget Koskei, who also broke a record, a marathon record. And the media coverage for both people was very different, because I think he had about 80-90% and she had 4%. So I think moving forward, there must be a deliberate effort to make sure that women are also covered in the same way. At least 50-50, just get them out there. If they've attained something, let's talk about it.
Yeah.
Let's talk, let's say, this is awesome. Yeah.
That's a very good point. It's one I'd just like to pick up with Gurupreet, if possible. So Gurupreet, you're saying that obviously within shooting, you've now got gender, you know, the mixed gender teams. Was a lot made in the media of that? And have the very good female shooters got the same sort of media coverage as their male counterparts?
You know, the sport of shooting is again going through a kind of transition. There have been changes at the highest level, where the new committee that came into the ISSF deliberately went this route of modernizing sport shooting. Because in the past, we were getting very little coverage due to certain events not being what they call TV friendly, in the sense that you would see a person, you know, in football or hockey, there's a lot of activity going on. Sport shooters are mostly just standing still, or they're lying on the ground. There is no dynamic activity. So they decided to come up with a way of trying to make it more viewer friendly. And one of the things they did was start this, start changing up the event. So ever since they did that, they realized that one of the important things, and I think Caroline has also mentioned, is to try and get local role models in your sport. So what they did, they started highlighting the top athletes in each type of sport, whether it was a shotgun, whether it was rifle, and tried to market around them, to try and show them that sports personalities are a commodity that can be monetized if done well. They also introduced a kind of a monetary system where they would pay the top athletes at the end of the year. Not pay them, but they would win monetary prizes instead of just a trophy or a medal. When I take the example of now how, I wouldn't say that the media really highlighted females or males. It was a bit of an equal thing. The ISSF consciously try and make relevant posts on their website and on Instagram and all that. You know, in terms of viewer friendliness, they have really consciously put both genders there, women and men. So I wouldn't say that they were trying to be, but they have done their part. And also, the athletes themselves realize that they are now a marketable commodity. So they have started marketing themselves in a way that they can attract sponsors. Because again, as Caroline said, the problem is that we live in a bit of a patriarchal society. And the fact that you cannot earn money from a sport becomes one of the main things that your parents will look at, or your peers, or yourself, if you're going to go and become a professional athlete and not be able to earn from it. So the realization that maybe you can't earn through the conventional side of it, which is big prize money, but there are new avenues open, that is like social media marketing and sponsors that are willing to endorse a certain athlete based on their ability. I think there's a bit of change happening, but it's slow, obviously, and it's not anywhere near what it could be.
No, but they're great points. Sorry,
Sarah, can I say something?
Yes, sure.
So I want to say that that, for example, in rugby at the Africa level, there's been a deliberate effort to promote and to raise the profile of the women game. And create, you know, like a sustained perception about the game, and this has been done as a deliberate campaign in social media that has featured, you know, women who are playing well, women who have done well, and this is across the continent. You know, if I look at the countries, Ghana, Kenya, Madagascar, Cote d'Ivoire, Tunisia, South Africa, Senegal, Uganda, Zimbabwe, and so forth. So women who are seen as role models in the sport in those countries have been put together, and a campaign has been created with messaging that goes out to say that, you know, you can't stop us, you can still do this, and you can do this and the other. And this has really helped to improve the image of the sport across Africa. And I think this is something that can be done. Is something that's available. Something that can be borrowed. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a great point, and it is something that can be done relatively cheaply. You know, people have got access to social media, so it's something that a concerted approach. Doreen, if I could come to you just a minute, I'm just going to bring it back slightly. You spoke about the discipline behind shooting, and this is yet something else that I think it's a really good way of selling sport as a an activity that enhances people's skills when they go out into the wider job market. Would you agree that that's generally you really, really do?
Yes, I would definitely agree to that. And just similar to what Caroline was saying in terms of her experience as a student and as an athlete, I would say I have a similar experience, but as a career person and an athlete. I joined shooting fairly late, so to speak. I've been in the sport for only a few years. And I have always had a struggle whenever there is an international meet to have a prioritization between my work assignments and or work travel and the travel required for me to represent my country in the sport. And the push that I have made with my colleagues and my management teams have been the benefits that this brings to the table for them as me as an athlete. However, just not looking at myself in this case is to answer your question now more directly is how do we ensure that this message is passed on to the general population? We have been fortunate that one of our shooters at a very young age and also in a very short time in shooting has been recognized by the Kenya government and been awarded one of the awards during our national events. And yeah, you know, this kind of recognition is the kind that we need to be seeing more of, for people to be saying that, look, as a result of this sport, this is the outcome that we can expect. And also changing the narrative when it comes to our sports stories, a lot of focus has been, yes, that so-and-so has won as a medal or has won or broken a record. But what is the story around how the sport is impacting the individual's life? And I know many women who are juggling quite a number of things can be able to share their personal narratives in this regard. So for us to be able to showcase this and to bring the great wider population into our way of thinking, being able to showcase how the discipline that we're getting within our sports, prioritizing how we must prioritize our work priorities, our careers, our academics, and everything else, and still deliver at the end of the day, and is something that we should really highlight as sports people.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much for that. And I think what we probably all agree as a panel is that sport gives you these qualities that are absolutely transferable across both other sports and also work and family life as well, with discipline and the ability to plan your time. I'd like to move on because we spent quite a lot of time on that topic, although I've got some great points out of it that we can share at the end. But I'd just like you now, and I'm going to come to each of you in turn, but again, ask you to be quite brief on this. You've all made your way towards the top of your sport. You're all on boards. You're also all, in terms of your jobs within society, you're all high achievers. I just wondered if you could share what your biggest learning has been along the way. So it might be a challenge that you faced that you overcame in a certain way. So what has been your biggest learning along the way? And I'll come to you first, Elizabeth, please. You know, you're a highly achieving lady. What has presented you with barriers on that journey, and how have you got there?
Thank you, Sarah. Well, as I said earlier, I was a player and I became a team manager. But you see, unfortunately, when I became a team manager, when we were going to our first All-African Games in Bulawayo, instead of taking a woman team manager as the manager for a women's team, they rather had to take a man. So I went to the ministry and said, no way, this cannot be. How can a man chaperone women's team? So the man was left out. And since then, I had a lot of enemies because of that. But I still persisted. And then I joined hands and I went, because of the security services, the job that I was doing a director of prisons and in a high position as such, I was made the hockey representative of the security services and therefore was able to control certain decisions of the security services and was able to get them together. And that was how I even got into the National Association. Other than that, it would have even been difficult for me as a woman. And then from there, you know, you have to rise. And then I wouldn't keep to myself. I have to move forward. I have to always try to find ways and means of getting what I want for hockey. Even right now that we are going for the youth games in Zimbabwe, we are finding it really difficult. But I said, by hook or crook, we have to go. And therefore, wherever we have to find money or funding, I have to go ahead and do that. In fact, my boss is very good. He's a CEO, very helpful. He provided the test for us, but it's not everything that the president can do. I am, in fact, the vice president of the Ghana Hockey Association, and therefore had to make my voice heard as a woman. And therefore, I go to places that men probably would be rejected, but I had to go. And therefore, sometimes we women have the problem of when you want to get to the top, the people assume that probably you use something to be able to get there, but not knowing that from playing, coaching, team manager and whatnot, you have built that confidence to be able to face the world and to be able to go out there to be able to get what you want. And in fact, that is what I have done so far to be able to get to where I am. But unfortunately, most of our ladies, when there's that problem of, you know, rumors and other things going on, women, we sort of back out and then we sit back and then let the men have their way. Yes. But that is not how we should do. We should try as much as possible to be able to dialogue with them, to be able to find a way around them, to be able to get what we want in hockey. And that is how probably we are going around that, or I am going around that. Fortunately for me, I have been made the chair of the Women's Commission in Ghana, and therefore we'll be able to also have a voice to be able to get together, rally the women organizations, the NGOs, and other women's association to be able to empower women in all aspects. In fact, we realized that.
I'm going to stop you there. Sorry, Elizabeth, I'm going to stop you there just because we're a bit pushed for time. But your message is people have got to take their self-confidence and create chances for themselves as well as help getting other people to help. That's lovely. Thank you very much indeed for that. If I could ask Gurupreet the same question. Well, in terms of challenges, I know you're a bloke, you're a man, you're sitting there in that, but there will be challenges that both men and women face in moving up through an organisation. So can you just give me briefly one of the challenges that you think is fairly across the board and how you've overcome it?
Yeah, there is definitely challenges for both genders. Like I said, you know, sports shooting has its own kind of unique way of changing things. What I faced is that when I came into the sport, again, I came into the sport a bit late. And the people who were running it, they were running it on a very outdated system where they didn't believe in updating it. They didn't believe in technical skills. It was like a social club, which was there for fun, but it was not there to take the sport to the highest level. And when you have leadership that is not interested in promoting it to a level where you can get to the pinnacle of sport, you find that nothing moves. So my main challenge was to try and come into those committees, start slowly, become a captain of my section, and then move from there, get appointed.
Brilliant. Sorry. Thank you.
Get, yep. Sorry. get co-opted onto my federation's committee, and then from there, try and make my way up, and now I'm the Secretary General. Again, with the women, what we're trying to do is give them a voice by co-opting them first from the Kenya Women's Cooking Club, and then giving them the challenge of them coming and fighting the elections and coming up to the spot where, because all of us do this as a voluntary thing. And I believe that if you have passion for the sport, that's when you can serve. If you don't have that passion, then you're not going to come and be in that position and serve to the ability that you really need to. I'll just leave it at that.
That's fantastic. So the way I'm interpreting that is that you're asking the leadership to promote the sport and to support people into career ladders moving up through it or to take opportunities. So that's very, very good points. Thank you very much for that. We'll come to we'll come to Doreen again. Same thing, you know, challenges that you've faced and your advice to people who are looking to make their way up a ladder. Hi, Doreen.
Oh, thank you. I think that was for me. I lost the connection there for a moment. But just very quick, I believe the question is still the same on our biggest learning. For me, it has been in leadership and taking on leadership. You know, when you're in when you're not in leadership, when you look at the opportunities, like, oh, when I get in there, I will change everything and we'll do it within 2 months. And you know, hockey will be totally new in Kenya, whatever it is that you may be aspiring to do. However, it doesn't quite work like that. As Gurpreet has mentioned, you know, you first have to work with the people that are already there. Elizabeth mentioned the same, you know, going and knocking the right doors. And so change management has been one of the biggest lessons I have learned, which is working with people, understanding where they're coming from, and then working with them to make the change possible. And quite often you find that is when you bring people together is when you're able to move farthest. And to do this also in an iterative manner, so step by step, we'd love to boil the ocean, but it's not quite possible. So, you know, what is that first step that you can make? If it's just as simple as getting those crèches available for the women at the international or the national sports festivals, then start with that and then move it down further down to the grassroots. If it is ensuring that there's funding for women who need to juggle their families and the sport, then start off with that and then progressively get more people and buy-in and then move forward. So take it step by step, even as we take on leadership roles. Thank you.
Love that. That's great. Thank you very much indeed. Jackie, to you, a challenge that you faced and a learning point you've taken from it.
I think one of my biggest challenges was as a player, I was very passionate. I think I'm a very passionate player, enough playing the sport. And that transition just from now I've gotten to the age where I've transitioned now into a coach, into full-time job, professional, or a teacher. And that transition was a challenge for me because, number one, initially I wasn't educated enough to move to the next step. And I think that's a lot of That's an area where most people struggle with. What will they do after they stop playing? They haven't planned ahead. So getting yourself educated, knowing what you want to do. For me, I think the union has been great because they helped in this transition. I love to serve. I've loved to coach for such a long time. And even before the position that I have now, I was already coaching, helping out, and doing things within the community. So this is what we need to find out, what we want to do next. What is the plan next? Or am I planning as a player? That transition is very important. So for me, that was my biggest challenge.
Did you, just a question on that. Did you find you got a lot of support in that process, or was it very much you trying to find the information and helping yourself there?
I think I'm one of the few lucky ones because my family was very supportive and really helped me out. But I had to find my way. I had to find my way through trying to find out what I wanted to do. So support, yes and no. But in terms of the immediate family, I was lucky enough to get that support. So
yes. Thank you. Caroline, you're the last one to answer this question. And I just wondered, you know, you've had a lot of experience in both sports, but can you sort of highlight a particular challenge that maybe you found in hockey, in your hockey journey, and how you overcame that, whether it be playing the sport as a youngster or progressing along the line? What would your answer be there?
The biggest challenge was always resources and structures for advancement, structures for, you know, what to do next. And I believe mentorship along the way. So when I started playing, the closest mentors and support I had was a rugby family that lived in my area. And I remember actually going to them to get a colored t-shirt to play. And then there was a boxing family. So for me, it was the sports people in my environment. When I played, the girls didn't have resources. I remember paying, in those days, airport tax for my teammates to travel to Zimbabwe. The association could not pay that. The ladies association couldn't pay. The Kenya Hockey Union couldn't pay. The government didn't provide. And I paid the $20, then it was a lot of money for me, especially because I was paying for my whole team with an agreement that when one day when they got empowered, they would pay back. Of course, that didn't happen. And then the other thing I found along the way was competition, that competition in spaces where we needed to have collaboration, because there was only one international tournament that we could play in the year. Maybe in the year it would just be the All Africa Games and so forth. And sometimes, because you are competing to be that left winger or that one of the 16 players on the team, there were a lot of other things happening around that. And because there were no structures where, you know, you could present maybe complaints or receive support. And I think that in sport, we need to look at that, you know, like there's certain situations where people are put against one another. And in my team, we worked very hard to be on the team. All of us were either in college or university, and we did our own fundraising from friends and well-wishers. So finally, I think also awareness of what is available to us, what is the right of the player, what is the recourse for certain things. And I know your question is about the challenges that I faced then, but I can see the solutions and I can see some things that have happened in the past few years. But I think that we need more transparency around. I know that the leadership has been trying their best and everybody tries their best with what that they have. But I think we need some transparency around the constitution. I've come to learn in life that if you fail to plan, then you're planning to fail. So I've also come to learn in my career that looking at things strategically can help you survive even in a tough time. So for example, we say there's no funds, there's no resources, but organizations today are looking at where they want to put their money. Investors are looking at where they want to put their money. And today we are aware that there are certain social or economic or environmental things that, you know, people want to know, does this organization take care of the environment? How do they treat women and so forth? These are clever ways of getting support for the game. In rugby, what we did is we decided to brand our games. We decided to have the men's game, we branded the 15th game, we branded the 7th game, and then we introduced women as a brand. And you'd be surprised, there are some sponsors who are happy to throw their money around women. You know, they think, oh, we would like to support youth development. Maybe they don't want to support a national team going out. Maybe they're not interested even in the men's game, but they're happy to support something to do with children. They're happy to support something to do with women. And so there's a lot of things that we can do strategically and put it out there. The other thing is, much as we have little resources, we can show how we are using those resources, and people can be attracted to that, to saying, wow, I'd like to be seen in this particular aspect of the game. I'd like to support this game in this way. And then engagement, strategic engagement with who holds what we want, with the government, you know, with IOC, with NOC, and so forth. So I see that I've learned that if we're strategic about things, and we didn't know, we were just playing this game.
Yeah.
We were just running around and doing our best and getting selected. That is what was lacking then. But I see an opportunity for the future. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. I think I feel like you've been looking at my notes here, Caroline, because I was about to ask each and every one of you. We've talked a lot about the sort of the theories and the thinking behind things. I wonder, because we're coming towards the end, whether we can have a think about practical steps. And that's a very practical step, you know, putting together a strategic plan that will appeal to a sponsor or will appeal to the marketing department of a company that's got some money. So that's one way. I just wondered if each of you, if I come to each of you, and we could, this is a really great example of us sharing ideas from across sports and from across nations, ways that you think we can practically address some of the things that are lacking. So whether that be equipment, whether that be turf time, whether that be people who deliver courses, whether that be competition between various either clubs or countries or schools, can you each come up with a one or two practical solutions to the issues that are prevalent in or across Africa? Throwing this at you a bit, so who shall I come to first? Doreen, you look like you're ready to jump in there with an answer.
Well, I'm not too sure about ready to jump in, because this has been one of the questions that we have struggled with in terms of how do we make this grand idea as practical. And I do agree in terms of being strategic. That is one of the things that as the Women Commission and the NOC that we have been really pushing for in terms of giving strategic training to women leaders in our various national federations. But part of that has been, how do you make it executable? How do you make sure that that strategic plan does not gather dust on our shelves? And this is where I still come back to that, my earlier point around iteration, is we need to find our allies. And a lot of what we intend to do cannot be done alone or as small group of individuals. We need to reach far and wide in order to have the right kind of people working with us. As Gurupreet had said, this is a volunteering, most of us are volunteering in what we do. So we need to bring in different mindsets, different skills to the table, in order for us to be able to move things forward. So if I am good in technology, for example, so I will bring in my technology expertise. Listening to someone like Elizabeth, you know, you can just hear the leadership in her voice. So, you know, bringing in someone that of that caliber, you know, to have the right conversations with the government and the kind of people that we need to open certain doors, you have to bring in all these people and not just think about working with your small teams. And even some of these may be the people that you run against when you're fighting for a position in an office. So finding that way to collaborate, I think, would be a first practical step. You know, just learn how to collaborate.
Yeah. That's brilliant. And if I could just sort of expand on that a little bit, that is absolutely transferable to whatever level of organisation you're talking about, isn't it? Because, you know, yes, it can work across a national association, but it could also work within a small school community. It could work within a township. You know, it could work anywhere. It's the collaboration you need. Thank you, Doreen. That's fantastic. Gurupreet, what are your thoughts on somewhere, you know, something practical that people listening to this can take away and actually apply to their situation?
I don't know if I have the right skill set for this, but what we have tried to do, because in our case, we realized that there's a very big disconnect between other sports and the wider public as to what sports shooting is. So we have started trying to engage from the very top, going from the ministry to the Olympic Committee to our local firearms bureau, and coming down instead of starting at the grassroots, because there's no way we can go to the grassroots if we don't have our structures in place. We have also started all the way from the ISSF by asking them for equipment donation. You know, in our case, equipment donation is very, very key, because other sports, the equipment is locally available from a sports shop. But in our sense, we don't get it in a normal sports shop. So one of the challenges that we had and what we are addressing, and I think this is something that maybe it can benefit all sports federations, is trying to find a cohesive way that we can get waivers and exemptions on equipment that is being donated by international federations. Because like has already been mentioned, there's a lot of organizations out there that are very willing to give equipment, to give technical officials, to give courses. But when somebody says, okay, I'm going to donate a container load of hockey sticks, for example, the donation is very well received in time. But when it arrives here, we have the problem of trying to look for taxes, for paying the duties and taxes, which is not catered for, obviously, by the person donating, because it is, at the end of the day, they've done their part. And active federations are already very cash-strapped. So what we have been trying to do is to try and engage with the ministry on an individual federation basis. But again, I know we've had conversations with even the National Olympic Committee that this should be an onus of the Olympic organization, or all federations as a whole, that equipment that is donated should, obviously with a lot of, because the only reason you don't get an exemption is you don't want that equipment then to be commercially sold into the market. But if we can find a way where that kind of stuff happens, it can make things a lot easier for fringe sports or marginalized sports, that at the end of the day, you know, if the kids have the equipment that they're supposed to train with, then it makes the whole process a lot easier.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's one of the things that's very obvious. There is a willingness to give equipment and to give advice and to give support, but it's just actually, you know, as you say, I'll use your phrase, how do you execute that? How do you actually make that happen? So that's a great point. Thank you. I'm just looking down there. Jackie, have you got an example of a way that a problem can be overcome, whether it be equipment or resources or training?
Yes. Before we even get to resources or training, we need to make sure that if there's an institution, maybe a university or a national association, if they have a male team, then they must have a female team. This is, we need to encourage more of this, because if we only have maybe the male teams just getting more airtime, more media coverage, maybe more funding from the government, and the female teams are not getting the same, then it's not okay. Now, I'm talking this from a broad perspective, of not necessarily, because my country, I think there's a lot happening, and there's a lot of support in both teams. But I know in some African countries, that's not the same. And we need to encourage that we have both teams participating. Yeah.
Yeah.
So for me, in terms of solution, that's one of my solution. I don't know if that could be a policy, and having and making sure that we have maybe a third of the panel members being women, that will help. And of course, lots of media coverage would assist. Thank you.
Thank you. Absolutely. Media coverage. And why settle for a third? Let's say 50%. 50%.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll move you across. I'm just going to see how I see you in front of me. Caroline, you're next on my screen. So do you have a practical solution to a practical problem?
Yes, I think if we're looking at gender, then we just need to be deliberate and say that knowledge or skill does not rest with one gender. And I don't see the challenge in say, I know our country, for example, in Kenya, looks at gender, the gender rule to be 30-70. But I know organizations in our country that have 50-50, for instance. So I think there's no monopoly of knowledge. It doesn't rest with one gender. And so I think we should be deliberate if we really want to drive the conversation of gender and we're looking at women, we should specify and have it like the way I'm seeing in rugby, saying that we want to see stronger women participation. Therefore, let's have an advisory committee or a structure that says we're looking at women for the next 5 years. And then we have deliberate plans and actions that are measurable, and then we drive it. And I think it needs to come with education around what we were saying, that it's not competition. It's not saying that men are better or worse or anything like that, but it's like encouraging, you know, that growth. If you're a parent and you have both sons and daughters, you know, even amongst your same-sex children, some of the challenges, and you might want to give more attention to one to bring them to a level when you know that they're not down. But you don't say that you're discriminating against your children. You know, there are those you may want to support in a different way compared to others. And I think the first thing we can start with is, what do we have at hand? What do we currently have? We have to leverage the current social capital we have. What I mean is, and I want to go to Doreen's point of allies, is there are people who are dissenting. We're sports people. We compete and we, but it doesn't mean that loser loses or winner takes it all. We need to have proper stakeholder engagement in our strategic planning. Let's involve all stakeholders and let them feel their voice has been brought to the table. Sometimes the solution we are looking for rests with us. It rests with those people who are in the game. So let's have an open strategic engagement and let's bring all these voices on board. You'll find the solution we're looking for rests within our social capital. So when we shove others and we leave them aside, sometimes we lose the opportunity that is facing us. And then finally, the stakeholders includes government. When we look at the constitutions of our countries, when we look at the Sports Act, etc., there's gender mentioned somewhere. How do we leverage that? How do we show government that we need these structures and we can help them to deliver on the plans that they have? So when we talk of allies, who are the other people who are not in hockey, but who can help? That's how Rugby Kenya has taken off. Some of the ladies there have never played the game, but they brought in the management. They brought in, you know, the funding. They brought in the idea. And some of them have found such inspiration for the sport that they've embraced it better than those who played that game. So how can we include allies who didn't play the game, but can help us with the skill that we lack?
Brilliant. Thank you. Elizabeth, can you wrap up for us with the, I mean, you've listened, I've seen you nodding on several occasions, which means there are points being made there that you agree with, but can you succinctly give me your viewpoint on this? What can that person who is in a club or in a community group and wants to make hockey a very important part of their lives, what can you and us and we give them to help them do that?
As I said earlier, women are underrepresented. And then, just like Caroline said, if we are able to get an affirmative action for a representative on the various national associations, you know, these women will have a voice and then will form some sort of alliance and be able to make their voice heard. So there must be a concerted effort for us to have women representatives on the various associations. And then we can use whatever we have as role models. And these people that are coming in could be role models. And then we get all of them together to push the agenda forward, to make our voice heard in all aspects. But then when we leave the majority of the NAs to the men, definitely we're going to have underrepresentation of the gender, especially women in the various positions. And therefore, that is one of my solutions that there must be, because the constitution itself doesn't specify that we must have, though the IOC had made it a point that we must have about 50%, 40% representation of NOCs by 2020. We haven't reached that way at all. And there are some NAs that have only two, just like I said, in Ghana, we have only two women out of 13. And that's way, how do we have our voices, how can we have our voice heard? And if we have much in hockey, in rugby, in football, I mean, we can form an alliance to be able to put the agenda of gender disparity in sports, and not only in hockey, but in the whole sports. And that is the formation of the alliance based on the affirmative action. That is my
Brilliant. Thank you very much indeed. I have, you might have seen me scribbling notes throughout this hour and a half, and I've got so many sort of points that you've all made, and I thank you so much for all that you've given.
Excuse me, Sarah.
Hello.
Excuse me.
Nashon.
Yeah, very quickly, I would like to give some practical examples how we can come out of the quagmire that we find ourselves in. I would like to address two or three areas. One, I want to address the area of the myth, the African myth we have that the woman's place is the kitchen. And the women seems to have accepted that. But the problem is the women themselves bring these problems to themselves. They are a problem to themselves. You know, when the women have the children, most of the time, the men are not there taking care of the children. The women take care of, when they go to buy birthday gifts for the children. For the girl, you buy a doll. For the boy, you buy a gun. When you're back in the house, the boy is chased out of the kitchen. He's told, go and play with the other boys outside while the sister is helping the mother to cook. So what happens? When these children grow up, they know. The girl knows that my place is the kitchen, and the boy knows that my place is out with other men. So that is a problem the women must solve. They must start solving that all the way, you know, back from their own home states. Number two, the jealousy. You know, women are jealous. They are jealous against one another. You know, the women are ready to be rather led by a man rather than being led by a fellow woman. That is a problem that only women will have to change. So they have to change that. From their own turf. The men have to some religion. You see, the issue of when women get married, they are told that now you'll have to stop your extracurricular activities and you have to take care of the babies. That can be sorted out through a conversation between the man and the woman. Another practical example, which I think Jackie mentioned, is Africa Hockey Federation must come up and impress it on the national associations to have it, have all the national associations have slots. Associations have reserved for the less agenda. You see, the problem here, when we talk about gender, we all look at it as we are talking about women. Have reserved places for the less agenda. Like us in Kenya Hockey Union, we have reserved two-thirds 2/3 will always be reserved for the less agenda. And it is the key positions. If the president is a male, then the deputy president must be a woman. If the secretary is a woman, then the deputy secretary must be a man. If the fixtures secretary is a man, then the deputy must be a woman. So if Africa Hockey can impress on the national associations to have it, you know, actually put or included in our constitutions, that will help. I know we are talking about 50-50, but we have to start somewhere. As you heard Elizabeth say, in Ghana, they only have two. In countries like Egypt, I don't know how many they have, but if they have more than one, I would be surprised. And in some other national associations, they have none. It's all men dominated. So let's start from Africa, because I know FIH is doing a lot, and FIH is demanding for 50-50. But before you talk about 50-50, can you have a start point? And let's be realistic. If you call for 50-50 in Africa at this point in time, it might not come that easy. But start somewhere and push for 50-50. I'll leave at that three. Thank you.
Thank you, Nashan. I'll just quickly wrap up.
Thank you, Sarah. Back.
Sorry, I was going to say I'll wrap up and then hand back to you, Nashan, to close the meeting. From what we've said, I think the summing up points that I hope everybody who's listening to this, and thank you all very much for your time on this, I think the things we can take from it are a need for strategic alliances, both within and without the sport. We need to engage from the top down to the grassroots level. We definitely need to use social media to sell our role models and to sell our sport. We need a deliberate pushing of the agenda to make sure that that gender remains really high as a priority. We need to aim high. Some of us on this call are saying 50-50. Nashan is being very realistic and saying maybe 30-70. And I think as well, underlining all of that is education at every single level and really sort of, you know, pushing it through schools, clubs, communities, etc. Thank you so much for your time, everybody. I'll now hand back to Nashan to close the meeting. But thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you very much, Sarah. You know, I joined late and like a confirmation, did my boss had a message through before you started? That is Mariaka. Before I say anything.
Marika, you're on mute. You're on mute, Marika.
Sorry, Sarah. Thank you, Nashan, to call me your boss, but I am not your boss. We are together in the committee. And I think you, as the host, have to close the meeting. But I like to take the opportunity. I'm very impressed by all your contributions, and especially that you were speaking so freely. And that means for me that you felt safe, and that's the biggest compliment that you can give us. So you really contributed very well. Nashan, it's up to you now.
Thank you very much. I know we are together in the committee, and there is always somebody who takes the leadership, and that is what actually leads to the success of that committee. I want to thank each and every one of you who have taken part in this today. Thank you very much for your time, of the many that are about to come. And I'm sure that we will build on this one. And we just don't want to come and, talk and go. We want to see changes coming into play. We want to influence Africa Hockey Union to do something. We want to influence our sports ministries and our national associations. And I'm saying that our sports minister in Kenya is a lady. And that is a plus for us. And I think from this point, as we go back to our countries, let's see how we can influence the gender issue when it comes to sports, so that in another 5 to 10 years, actually, we should not be talking about gender parity. It should be automatic. It should be a 50-50 and nothing less. It's only us. And if we pull together, it will work. I know Europe is way ahead of us, but we can cut. And with those few words, I say thank you very much, and God bless you all.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Applause for you. Well done.
Bye, everyone. Thank you so much, everyone.
Lovely to see you. Bye.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Bye.